gathering this is, to be able to enter the mosque, by the tawfiq of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, to be able to remember his blessed Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the greatest man ever born from a woman, the greatest man ever born. He said, Sayyidi wala Adam wala Fakhr. He said, I am the best of the son of Adam, and I say this without pride. My dear respected brothers, the name Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the scholars, they went into detail about the name Muhammad, what it means and where it stems from. And these scholars of language, they said that if you combine all the good traits and you put them into one thing, that thing will be called Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That all the good traits to be found in a thing, that thing will be called Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This was the man Muhammad, the greatest man ever to walk this earth. Ayyuha al-ikhwatul kiram, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was given the title Habibullah. And if you look at it from a linguistic point of view, it means the intensely loving. He was loved by Allah, and this title was Aybaf Khalilullah. In the Prophet's time, alayhi salatu wasalam, some of the people, they wanted to mock the Prophet and they wanted to harm the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And they said, you are abtar, because the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he had not yet had any males. So they said, you are abtar, you were cut off. Your line is cut off. What did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say in the Quran? Inna shariyaka huwa al-abtar. The one who harms you, the one who treats you, he is cut off. And the ulama of tafsir, they said, in reality, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, his name is mentioned every single day. It is part of the article of faith. So in an allegorical way of speaking, he is like the father of all of us. The one who harms the Prophet, he is cut off from Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. Vice versa, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he is connected to Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, and he is like the father of all in a manner of speaking. This was the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we know that it's part of our deen and part of our faith to love the Prophet, to love this man. It's a part of your faith. It's not just a matter when a person he says, I love the Prophet. It is actually part and parcel of who you are as a believer. Umar ibn al-Khattab, in an authentic narration, he came to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he said, I love you, Ya Rasulullah. But he made an exception. Except not over myself. And then the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, Ya Umar, you will not truly believe. And the ulama, they explained this. They said that your faith will not truly be complete until I am dearer to you than your father and your children and yourself. So Umar radiallahu anhu, he went and he contemplated and he came back. He said, Ya Rasulullah, you are dearer to me than myself. And then the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Now Umar, your faith is complete. It is part of faith to love this man, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In one battle, there was one Sahabi, he was injured. The Prophet Muhammad, he sent a Sahabi to go and find this Sahabi. And when they went and found him on the battlefield, he was neither amongst the dead and he was neither amongst the living, but he was about to die. And then he found him, the Sahabi, he found this man, and he said to him, he said, what do you have? What would you like me to say to Rasulullah? He said, I have just one thing. Give salam to Rasulullah. Imagine this man is dying. He's speaking his last words. He said, give salam to Rasulullah on my behalf. And give a message to the Ummah of Muhammad. La udhra lahum yawm al-qiyamah. They have no excuse on the day of judgment. That if anything happens to the Prophet whilst you are alive, you'll be held responsible. This was the love and this was the eminence and this was the stature the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was given. The companions loved him. The companions loved him and their love was on display. They gave their life for him. When they said, my neck for your neck, Ya Rasulullah. When they were in the battlefield and the way they protected the Prophet, the way they galvanized around the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. One man, he was being punished for a crime that he had committed in the time of the Prophet. And as he was being punished for a crime that he had committed, one of the Sahabi, he said in front of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, doesn't this man learn, does this man understand how many times does he have to be punished before he realizes the error of his ways? And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told him, be careful what you say, because this man loves Allah and his Rasul in his heart. It is part and parcel of who you are. It is your identity. It is part of our identity that we internalize that love into our heart, and that we be fully accepted with what this man brings, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Musa split the ocean. Musa was given the instruction to split the ocean, and his staff hit the water and the ocean split. But the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't have anything tangible, yet he split the moon. And this was at a great distance from him, but the ocean was in front of Musa, yet the moon was split. While the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when chakka al-qamar, and the moon split, never in the history have we heard of a man, or have we heard of a prophet, where a prophet, he dabs his fingers into water and water flows from between his fingers, and it runs from between his fingers, like what happened when they came back from the battle of Tabuk, and water ran from his fingers. This was the barakah that came out of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam's hand. Nowhere in the history is that to be found. Yes, it is true that Isa alayhi salam, he healed the dead, and he would go and he would say, "Rise bi-idhnillah," and he would rise. But the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, when he was next to the trunk of a tree in the mosque, and when he moved away from the trunk of the tree in the mosque, this miracle is hissi, it was something that was based on the senses. When he moved from this tree, the tree began to moan and wail. And as some interpreters say, it began to cry like a child. And the Prophet came and he consoled this. Imam al-Shafi'i and many other scholars have given a bit of interpretation about this. And they said this miracle was greater than the miracle of Isa bringing the life to death, because that dead person was a human being speaking with the soul, but this tree was an inanimate object that before that it could not speak, yet it spoke. And had the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam not come and calmed the tree, it would have stayed in that condition until Yawm al-Qiyamah. This is the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And they understood it, and the Sahaba, they understood it. One lady made the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam a garment. And the Prophet already had shortages of garments. So one day, a companion of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he sees him wearing that garment. So without any hesitation, he says to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Would you give me that garment?" And the Prophet never refused the request. So he said, "I'll give it to you." And after a while, the Prophet alayhi salam, he gave him that garment. The rest of the Sahabi said to that Sahabi, "Why did you do that? You knew that if you requested that thing, he would not deny you, yet you asked him." He said, "I did that because when I die, I could be enshrouded in that garment that his blessed body adopted." This is what they understood from the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. My dear respected brothers, the Prophet alayhi salam, he was born circumcised. And in the narrations and in his seerah, it is said that he never yawned. And one book of seerah mentions that he did not have a shade. You know, when you walk, you have a shade. They said that the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ did not have a shadow because of the nur that emanated from his body, alayhi salatu wasalam. He fasted consecutively, day after day. Yet when the man came to him and he said to him, "Ya Rasulullah, I fast consecutively," and the Prophet told him, "Don't do that. I do that. I am nourished by Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala," but not the case with yourself. And on one occasion when the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam went to sleep before having prayed the witr, Aisha radiallahu anha said to the Prophet, "Will you sleep without having prayed the witr?" The Prophet Muhammad said to her, "My heart is awake, but my eyes close only. My heart is awake." And so the Ahnaf, this was something that Abu Hanifa, he said, because of this, that when the Prophet Muhammad woke up, his wudu was not made void. So these are very important things to remember. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, if we look at a little bit about his character, I don't want to take too long. There was once a boy in the time of the Prophet. The etiquette and the manners of offering people is that when you drink, you give the person on your right. When you drink, that you give the person on your right. Once the Prophet Muhammad alaihi salatu wasallam, he drank some water. There was a boy on the right hand side of the Prophet, and there was an elderly man on the left hand side of the Prophet. So the adab and the etiquette was as the Prophet did. He asked this young boy, he said, "Would you give me permission to allow this man who's on my left?" That's the etiquette, that's the manners, that's the protocol. You can ask permission because he has the most right. And the boy said, "No, I have more right to drink from your blessed mouth than that man." And so he took the cup and he drank for after the Prophet alayhi salam's visit. Now, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, and it's just something to think of, he said that in an authentic narration, I can see you from behind my back. Ibn Kathir, he mentions the scholars, he said, do we take that literally? Could he really see from behind his back? Some said yes. Some said yes, faithful thought. Aisha radiallahu anha, she said about the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that when he began to sweat, that the sweat that he sweated generated light. It generated nur. This was what was emanating from the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. One last thing, Urwa ibn Mas'ud, when he came at Sulh Hudaybiyah, when they were making contracts, when Quraysh wanted to make a contract, and Urwa ibn Mas'ud, he came to see who this man Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was. And when he came and he saw who he was, and he went back to the people of Quraysh, he said to them, you best make a deal with this man. He said, wallahi, I have not seen people who revere their leader like they do this man. That when he spits, they shuffle with each other to see who is going to capture his spit. When he makes his wudu, they fight who is going to get his leftover water. He said, they do not look in his eyes. And when they speak to him, they speak in a tone lesser than his tone. Lesser than the tone of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. My dear respected brothers, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he mentioned in the Quran, he said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ وَمَلَائِكَتَهُ يُصَلُّونَ عَلَى النَّبِيِّ يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا صَلُّوا عَلَيْهِ وَسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا. This is a fi'al amr. Every single person, at least once in their life, is required to say, اللهم صلي وبارك على سيدنا محمد. At least once in their life. At least once. But the recommendation is that even if a person, he fulfilled and he occupied all of his adhkar in the remembrance of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, this would even not suffice. It would even be more recommended to do more than even if you fulfilled all of your remembrance with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This man was the greatest man ever to walk this earth. And there is no such thing as excess love for the Prophet. People say that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I just want to mention this very important point. He was a man. He was a man just like any other man. No, he was not a man just like any other man. If that were the case, even from a physical point of view, how was it that even from a physical point of view, he was able to fast two consecutive days? Two consecutive days, one after the other, yet he said, Allah nourishes my physical body. It was not only on a spiritual plane that he was the greatest, but even in a physical capacity, he was the greatest man. You cannot say he was simply an ordinary man, yet he excelled that which was ordinary. And there can be no such thing as excess love. You know why? Because the love of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it is based on loving Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. That's where you get the love from. This is in reality where it emanates from. It's like when the son of Ali radiallahu anhu, he said, oh father, he said, do you love me? He said, yes, I do. He said, do you love my mother, Fatima? He said, yes, I do. He said, do you love my grandfather? Meaning the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, yes, I do. He said, do you love Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala? He said, yes, I do. He said, how is it possible that you can love all of us? He said, when you love Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala by default, everyone benefits from that love. So when you have your faith based or love based on the love of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, there can be no such thing as excess love for the Prophet. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala knows best. وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين. جزاكم الله خيرا.